Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's so sad that we see a hall which is not completely full, but I guess it's for your safety and our safety and the safety of the players. So I'm afraid until the devil goes away, we'll have to do with this. It gives us pleasure to welcome you. This is our fourth concert of the season, and I think that we are progressing slowly onto the February season, which, God willing, should be a full season with four major concerts, COVID permitting. A gratifying feature of this season are the number of Indian players that have been inducted over the years, as promised by Marat many, many years ago. So please give them a hand. We have to thank our SOI members for supporting us through this rather vivid time, and also the players who stayed here through the whole period to train, to teach, and to inspire our Indian players to greater heights. The program today is a comparatively light one, but there are two major works. I am particularly happy that my dear friend Rohinton Nariman has agreed to our request to say a few words of encouragement in support of culture and particularly for the young. He is an avid music lover and very knowledgeable, so be careful what you say to him. And he listens to live music as much as time will permit. So please do welcome Rohinton Nariman. I forgot to mention, he's a pretty good lawyer also. Rohinton.
Thank you, Guru.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May we first begin with a round of applause for my very dear friend Khushru Santok. I don't think it would be an exaggeration to say that the entire cultural scene in Bombay has changed after he's become chairman of this august institution. I find from today's program that we begin with Saint-Saul's Carnival of the Animals. Now, most of you must be knowing that this is Saint-Saul's 100th death anniversary. In fact, he died just two or three days before, 100 years ago, on the 16th of December. And it is interesting to know that when he composed Carnival of the Animals, he didn't want it ever played during his lifetime. He thought that he would be written off as a cheap sort of composer. So he had in his will the fact that it would be performed only after his death. There were some private performances in his lifetime, but nothing to speak of. And it was in fact performed only in 1922, after he died. You will hear in the Carnival of the Animals the roar of the lion, the footsteps of the elephant, the thud of the tortoise, and many other such things, including the hopping of the kangaroo. And of course, it's most famous for the 13th out of its 14 movements, which is the swan, which is a very beautiful cello theme played by the cello. The next interesting work in today's program is also for cello and orchestra by Max Bruch. Now, Kol Nidre in Hebrew, means all vows. And really speaking, he took certain themes which were marriage themes, Jewish marriage themes, and produced this masterpiece. He was also at great pains in later life to point out that he was Protestant and not Jewish, because a lot of people thought that he was a Jewish composer having written this work. What a remarkable thing. It happened in 1893 at Cambridge. These two composers and three others were all given doctorates of music. What was remarkable was not that they got doctorates of music, but that These two had to replace even greater composers. Brahms had said no, which is why Bruch got a doctorate. And Gounod apparently was not well and therefore didn't respond. He died a little later in that year, as a result of which Saint-Saëns was called. Believe it or not, Tchaikovsky was the third composer called only after Anton Rubinstein, another great player and composer, said no. And then we had Arrigo Boito, who was the great librettist, known better as a librettist than as an opera composer. He actually wrote the libretto for the last two operas of Verdi. But he composed two well-known operas himself, Mephistophel and Nerona. And finally, Edvard Grieg was also given this honor. He was the only one who couldn't attend, being too sick to do so. And imagine what an evening that must have been in June 1893 at Cambridge University. Saint-Saëns actually played the piano in his suite for piano and orchestra called Africa. Bruch conducted Odysseus, Opus 47, one of his great works. Then we had Boito actually conduct the overture from Mephistophel. And Grieg, as I told you, was too unwell, so somebody else conducted his Peer Gynt suite. And Tchaikovsky went on the podium and conducted Francesca da Rimini, which is that very beautiful tone poem which puts to music Canto 5 of Dante's Inferno. So let me now not stay between you and the audience. I'm sure today's program will be as interesting, or if not more interesting, than what was given over 100 years ago. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. See how learned he is. It's frightening, chap. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this evening's concert by the SOI Chamber Orchestra under its concertmaster, Maestro Anton Kolodenko. I'm sure you must have already switched off your mobiles. If you haven't, please take a moment of your time to do so. Thank you. So without more ado, let's start the evening's program. In your program, you can see that the first piece is The Carnival of the Animals, composed by the charming and masterful French composer, Camille Saint-Saëns. It's a kind of loony fantasy about a visit to the zoo, where one sees different animals and birds, and also a leisurely walk in the forest nearby. From time to time, he injects in it humor, at times overt, at times tongue-in-cheek.
He starts off by writing, after all, I mean, when you visit the zoo, usually the first animal to visit is the lion. So the piece opens with an overture and a march of the lions. Now, originally, the piece was composed for just two violins, one viola, one cello, and one double bass in the string section. Today, of course, it is almost always played in an arrangement for a full string complement. In addition to the strings, you get a flute, a clarinet, a glockenspiel, a xylophone, and the mainstay of the entire piece, the most important instruments, are the two pianos. And believe me, ladies and gentlemen, they have a lot of work to do this evening. So we start off with a march with the lions in it, and since the lion is the king of the jungle, anything associated with the lion has to be royal. So we have the introduction and the royal march of the lions. Maestro. Wasn't that royal enough? You could hear the rumblings in the piano and in the strings, which denoted the roars of the lion. Right. So now we visit the next two animals in turn, the first being the hens and the roosters. As the music will suggest, it suggests the hens pecking for the grain which is fallen on the ground. And the rooster manages to get a word in, which is a universal truth, and says cock-a-doodle-doo. That'll be on the clarinet. After the hens and the roosters, we have what you call the hemons in French, or the zigetai in Tibetan dialect. They are the Tibetan donkeys. They are huge donkeys, noted for their lightning speed. And that will be represented only by the two pianos, where you will see their fingers flying at lightning speed over the keys. The donkeys cannot run in a straight line, but they run zigzag or in circles. Maestro.
Thank you.
Well, in the next two animal descriptions, Sensos indulges in a little private musical joke, the overt humor which I spoke of in my introduction. He wants the tortoise, which is the slowest of all the animals, to dance to the fastest music, for which he borrows this can-can from Jacques Offenbach's opera, comic opera, Orpheus in the Underworld. Played 5 times its slower speed. Of course, the tortoise can't dance at that speed, so the music has to be played slowly at his speed. Maestro. Now, in the next, Sensos again makes this humorous, overt switch. Here, the difference was between fast and slow. In the next, the elephant, the difference is between heavy and light. The elephant, being the heaviest of animals, is supposed to dance with music which is light in character. For this, Saint-Saëns borrows from Mendelssohn's incidental music to A Midsummer's Night's Dream, the scherzo, and also from Berlioz's Damnation of Faust, the Dance of the Sylphs. Both these are originally written for instruments in the higher register, and they represent fairies, lightness. And which would be the most apt instrument to describe the heavy elephant but the double bass? So the double bass will play both these. When she plays the Mendelssohn, it might remind you of the tune Lavender's Blue, Dilly Dilly Lavender's Green. Maestro. Thank you. Well, that was the elephant. The next, we have just the two pianos. Can I be heard? We have the kangaroo, which is represented only by the two pianos, no strings. Their chords, as they ascend, they get louder and faster. As they descend, they get softer and slower, much as those marsupials would hop. Kangaroo. We now visit the aquarium. Now in the aquarium, I want to draw your attention to three different things. The first is the fish swimming in the water. That will be represented by the smooth melody played by the strings and the flute. As a result of the fish swimming, the water is turned into waves. That is described by trickling runs on the piano. And third, the drops of water which stick on the inside of the glass and trickle down on the glass are represented by the glockenspiel. The glockenspiel is an instrument which has bars made of metal, exactly like the keys of a piano. But whereas on the piano, you press them down, press the keys down. Here, you strike the plates with a hammer or a mallet. So, the fish swimming, strings and flute, the water in waves, piano, and the drops of water trickling down on the glass, glockenspiel. Thank you. Now we will consider the next two animals together. The first is the tongue-in-cheek humor I alluded to earlier. Characters with long ears. Saint-Saëns was referring to some of his friends, acquaintances, who were absolute idiots, jackasses, but he couldn't call them jackasses. So tongue-in-cheek, he says, gentlemen with long ears. It'll be played only by two violins, the first violin leader and the second violin leader. And you will see how the donkeys bray. And ladies and gentlemen, I would urge you to remember this because I will draw your attention to it again in the finale. After this, we'll have the cuckoo in the depths of the forest. It's a leisurely walk in the forest with the piano softly playing chords and the cuckoo, the clarinet, just playing two notes again and again. Cuckoo, cuckoo. It's frustrating for him. Instead of having a solo, he says, oh, solo mio. We next visit the birdhouse, the aviary. Ladies and gentlemen, I just want to point out again three things in this. The first is the very beginning where the strings buzz. and that represents the buzzing sound of the jungle in the background. The second, a virtuoso performance on the flute of one particular bird flying at breakneck speed. Believe me, ladies and gentlemen, this flute solo is going to take your breath away. And the third, occasional trills on the piano, which represent the trilling of the other birds in the aviary. Maestro. Next, we have something which audiences don't normally experience. Piano students practicing their scales and arpeggios in front of their teacher. They play it once, and the orchestra with a bang says, "No," again. And then they play it the second time, and again the orchestra says, "No," again. When they've played it four times like that, and the teacher said no again, when the fifth time around, you can hear the anger in the students and the impatience on the part of the teacher, who eventually says, "All right, go home and practice." And then we go immediately into the next one called fossils. Now, fossils, as you know, ladies and gentlemen, are remains of dead people or dinosaurs or whatever. Skeletons, bones. This is another one of the tongue-in-cheek humor which Saint-Saëns indulges in. Why fossils? Because according to him, and here, he quotes no less than six different melodies, which I will tell you in a minute. Why fossils? Because according to Saint-Saëns, these are long back. They have outlived their utility. On the xylophone, which again, like the glockenspiel, is made of bars, but made of wood, so that when they are struck, they have that tack, tack, tack kind of sound, which simulates the bones brushing together. The main theme in this is, of course, Saint-Saëns' own dance macabre, tararadam, 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 tam, 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 which is played from time to time on the xylophone. Interspersed are five other melodies which you may recognize. Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Stars, Au Clair de la Lune, two French folk songs, J'ai du bon tabac, Partant pour la Syrie, and Rosina's aria from Una voce poco fa, from the opera Barber of Seville. Maestro. Thank you. Now we come to what must be the most famous piece in the Carnival of the Animals, the Swan. Saint-Saëns never intended to be the dying swan, just the swan gliding gracefully on the waters of a lake. The idea of a dying swan was not his, but of the Russian ballerina Anna Pavlova, who in the year 1905 persuaded Mikhail Fokine to choreograph this music so she could dance to it as the dying swan. She has reportedly danced this 4,000 times in her lifetime, including the times in 1922 when she was in Bombay and in Calcutta. And when she was on her deathbed, her request was to bury her in that swan costume. So now we have our lead cellist playing the swan as gracefully as ever, gliding on the waters of a lake. And now, gentlemen and ladies, sorry, ladies and gentlemen, all good things must come to an end, so we now come to the finale. In the finale, practically all the animals join in here and there. See if you can recognize the lions roaring, the donkeys of Tibet running helter-skelter, the hens and roosters, the kangaroos, and the gentleman with long ears, I had told you at that time that I would make mention of it here. Towards the end of it, you will hear that same hee-hawing six times. It's as if the donkeys are saying, you laugh at us, you beride us, but it is we who have the last laugh. Maestro.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.